grandbabies today.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Isn't it exciting to be part of the family of God?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes. And it's wonderful having all these church babies.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Bring them up to know Jesus and to be close to us.
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And I know, yes, I know, Jesus' blood can make them all.
Grace runs deep.
straight to the one.
To fear, I am a child.
you've ever lived in condemnation, that song will set you free. He's already set us free, but you can shout with this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to thank you, Jesus. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Because my chains are gone.
Yes.
I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And light of love, His mercy. Chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And light of love, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Free from fear. We are free from condemnation. We can walk in
and what he has done for us, but we have to choose to walk there. Let's not listen to his lies. Amen? If you need freedom this morning, he's here to touch you, to set you free. Let's sing My Chains Are Gone, and let's let it go this morning. Say, Lord, I know I'm free because of you. Come on, reach in and talk to him this morning. Say, Lord, I want this bondage broken from my life. Lord, I know, God, you have taken everything from me. You have broken these chains, Lord. I choose to believe, God, what you have done for me, Lord. I thank you, God, because of who I am in you, Lord. I give you praise, God, for it. Hallelujah. The devil's a liar. Everything he says is a lie. Everything he says is a lie. Hallelujah. Come on, church. ready to bring our tithe and offerings to the Lord. This is a celebration. You know, the reason we have anything to give is because God gave it to us in the first place. Hallelujah. And He's given us the power to get the wealth that we have. And I just thank God for that. Thank God for all of you who are so faithful at Oasis of Love to support the ministry here. So we're going to give you the opportunity to come now. We just pray your blessings over this offering. Pray for all of you that as you give, many of you sacrificially, Lord, that you will just bless these, I pray, oh God, and bring back to them over and abundantly above anything they could begin to imagine because of their commitment to give. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted.
If my people, this is what God said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. How many of y'all ever heard me quote that before? But if my people, God said, my people, his people, the children of God, if they'll humble themselves and pray and seek his face, and listen to this, straighten the world out. You know, we can't make all the sinners do right. But he said, if my people, which are called my name, shall humble themselves, pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. And you know what that means. Now, I'm not saying all of y'all are wicked, and all of us are wicked, but please know, how many of y'all have the Holy Spirit work on you a little bit sometime and convict you of something? Come on now. And when he does, then if we'll humble ourselves and pray, and if we'll repent, then God will be faithful and just forgive us. Amen? Of that, the word of God is very clear on it. So if my people, which are called my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and the main thing, God's people need to pray. Amen. And if there's, and when the Holy Spirit, when you pray, and the Holy Spirit will reveal stuff to you. It'll tell you to be kinder, be gentler, come on, or be nice. Or it'll tell you to call your wife and apologize to her and tell her you was an old sorry dog. Some of you won't do it. How many of y'all really heard a little bit? I know some of you ain't going to vote on nothing this morning. That's fine. But how many of y'all heard the Holy Spirit prick you a little bit and tell you something you ought to change? Come on. Even with relationships. And see, he'll do it. He'll do it on a little scale, and he'll do it on big scale. He'll do it on a minor scale, and he'll do it on major scale. And if we'll humble ourselves and pray as we seek his face, reason some of us don't want to seek his face because we don't want him talking to us about nothing like that. Don't want to straighten us out sometimes. Come on. Have you ever almost had to walk around sometime and like, ooh, you don't want to look up because you're afraid that all-seeing eye is watching you? I appreciate the Lord looking around, watching over everything. Amen, don't you? Amen. Because he's seeing everything. Not a thing is being covered. And nothing that's covered right now will stay covered. One day it'll be revealed. And God will have the last say. And things can, you know, things can be bad. But I will tell you that if people will really pray and seek the Lord, God can change bad things. And God can turn things around. And I want you to know this is not over yet till the Lord says it's over. I'm talking about all the mess that's going on. That she mentioned some of it. It's not over until God says it's over. And then, and evil men, the word of God does say it. Evil men, I quote it again. Evil men and seducers will get worse and worse. That's what he said in these last days. And when I'm saying last days, somebody right now may say, well, you think the Lord's going to come any minute? I don't know, and you don't know, and nobody else in the world knows when he's coming. But when the Father says it's time, it's going to happen, and you'll know it. If the ones that are alive and remain will be called up together with the Lord, and you'll know it. The dead in Christ will rise first, because there'll be a trumpet, and the ones that are ready to go will hear that trumpet. It's my personal opinion, I don't think everybody in the world will hear it. I don't think the news medias that are spreading so much junk around, I don't think they will hear it. I think shortly after they'll know about it though. There'll be people on there bawling and squalling and telling even some of the people that work there that, you know, something happened and somebody told me that the cemeteries were all tore up. It looked like grenades exploded all over the place, you know, here and there, all out in there. And they went out to check it, and they went to their grave, or their mother, their grandmother, their grandfather, their dad, or whatever, that they knew, claimed to be a Christian, that they might have laughed at. And they will go out someday. And I honestly believe, now this is just my opinion, I believe the graves are going to burst open, dirt's going to go all over the place, the casket lids are going to blow off and everything else, just to show people that are left behind. Now, God wouldn't have to do it that way. He can get them out of there. He can get them right up out of dirt and nobody ever know they're gone. And the Bible says, though, the trump of God is sound, and the dead in Christ, will the ones that died in the Lord that are dead, and many, how many of y'all got them? Y'all got some ones that gone on before you, dead in Christ. They're going to rise first. And then we which alive remain will be caught up together, he said. They're going getting up first, and then we're going right with them. And I mean instantly then we're going to be changed and have a glorified body, and we won't be affected by none of this mess down here any longer. Amen? And when the time gets right, he's going to let that happen. The rapture of the church. You call me escapist if you want to, but the word of God declares it. And so I believe it. And whether I believe it or not, years ago the Baptist campaign had, the Word of God says I believe it and that settles it. No, if the Word of God said it, that settles it. Make no difference whether they believe it or not, or whether you believe it or not, or whether I believe it or not. Now it's to your benefit if you do, but if the Word of God says it, that settles it. It's going to happen just like God said it's going to happen. And then he's really going to take care of some things then. The Antichrist will be revealed, and I honestly believe there's a whole lot of things that are just heading up, the revealing of the Antichrist. But I do want to remind you of something. Thessalonians says for us not to look for the Antichrist, but to look for the Christ. And the man of sin will not be, talking about the Antichrist, will not be revealed until he that letteth is gone and will not let anymore. And I honestly believe with all my heart that that's the church, okay? I believe that that's the church, the bride of Christ. And until we're the thing that is restricting the Antichrist from being revealed right now. Now they're getting wheels in motion. They're getting programming done with computer science and everything else and technology to set up for a one world government and a one world money and a moneyless society. And I think y'all can understand that we're heading that way fast. But again, when I say fast, I cannot put a time frame on it. And you can't put a time frame on it. You may think you know, but all you're doing is just thinking. You know, you may think you know, but all you're doing is just thinking you know. That's all it is to it. And if I put a time, I would be just thinking I know. Or I think I got it all figured out. Well, guess what? Some things, his ways are past our finding out. You know, there's something, the mystery things it says belong to the Lord. Now, there's some things he reveals to his people. And I want you to know, and I said some of this to say something else I was going to say. How many of y'all know that in the last days, Joel said that he'll pour out his spirit upon all flesh? You know that's in there? Now, do you really know when the last days started? After Jesus went back to take his rightful place, seated at the right hand of the Father. That's over 2,000 years ago now at this point. That's when the last days started. And then the day of Pentecost was fully come. It was even prophesied in Joel about that. That's when the last days started. So we've been living in the last days. Okay? People talk about the last day. We've been living in the last days, and it's lasted all this time. But it's because God had a plan, and there was prophecy that hadn't been fulfilled. I mean, you know, some of y'all have seen prosperity fulfilled before your very eyes since you've been living. That was prophesied in the Word of God, if you've been paying attention or if you've read His Word. But let me, and most of you have, but let me say that rest of that scripture in Joel said that in the last days that your sons and your daughters, sons and daughters, that means lady folks, that means girls, your sons and your daughters. I've got a daughter, and she's not a little girl anymore. She's my girl, but she's mama's girl, and she's Young's girl, friend. But she's not a little girl anymore. She's my daughter, though, and she's a grown woman. She's even a grandma. And if you ask me, I'll tell you her age. Well, I won't tell you her age. I'll tell you she's born in 1968. Sumter, South Carolina, in the Air Force Hospital. That's all I'm going to tell you. I ain't going to tell you your age. You know what? For a lot of people nowadays, they can't even figure that out. There's people work cash registers, and they can't even make change if the computer don't work on the machine. If they can't put in the amount of money that's already automatic when the scanner scanned it, and you give them, if you gave them, say, a $100 bill, and you had $63.81, there's no way in the world they could count that out of that drawer and give you, they'll take 5 minutes and then they'll look, and most time it'll still be wrong. Am I telling the truth? But the Word of God says that your sons and your daughters would prophesy. So see, it's okay for women to prophesy in church, whether preaching or teaching or operating in the gift of the Spirit. It's biblical. It's okay. It's the Word of God. And then he said to men folk, because sons and daughters, both of them. But then he said, would dream dreams and see visions. And I'll be honest with you. Sometime I do, and sometime God says don't tell it yet, or reveal it, or let it out. There's always a timing. And then there's other people the same way. And I really don't know whether I'm old or young. I really don't know yet. Because young men had dreamed dreams, or young men, and old men had have visions, or one way or the other. It's the other way around, Francis said. So see, I'm confused right now, and I don't know. And I'm not the president of the United States. I'm just pastor of a church. But I do know it's biblical. It's the Word of God. for people to dream dreams and see visions or have visions. And I've watched a guy, I've watched several during this last year. I'm not just every time I turn around, I gotta have one on, I wanna see it. But I'm listening, I'm keeping my eyes and ears open, especially spiritually, and do know that it's biblical for godly men and women, the sons and daughters of God, to dream dreams and see visions. And there's some dreams that people have had that would blow you away if I stood up here and told you some of those dreams. And who am I to say that God did not give them that dream or not? Now, and when somebody prophesies, who am I to say that they're not prophesying correctly? And one thing we can do, we can pray and we can sit back and watch and see if it comes to pass. And he even said in one place, even if they miss it sometime, it still don't mean that they're a horrible person. Have you ever thought you knew something and thought you were telling it right and thought you were telling it? Have you? And then, but yet it was wrong. You missed it a little bit on something. Well, you know, people can do that, of course, too, with the things of God. But I want you to know that when the Lord gets ready to come, he's going to come, and you knew that already, but we don't know when that's going to be. And God can turn things around in America just like that. If people will just really be men and women of prayer, God can take a few and confound the mighty. God can take, you know, I think you understand some of the times when they'd get a whole army ready and God said, weed them down. We don't need thousands, I'll just take 300. And we'll go whoop the enemy with 300. And also when the armies would go out sometime, God would let the enemies see things up in the mountains that was really not even there. Except through the supernatural realm, it was there. And we don't know what God did, or we don't know what he caused the angels to do, or he would give the angels orders to do certain things. We don't know. I know even during our time, during the 60s, when the enemy was coming out against Israel, God caused bees. They were coming out with tanks against Israel. And God sent bees, swarms of bees. Who do you think created those bees? And you know, this morning I got in the car to come here, and a bee got in with me. And I just happened to have a good old faithful hard-hitting Harley hat laying on the dash. He landed on the steering wheel right where I want to put my hand. I said, "Ain't no way, Jose." I mean, bee. And I grabbed that hat and I whooped. I never even thought about telling this morning, but about the bees. But I whopped him down, and he, of course, I didn't know exactly where he went, and that kind of worried me a little bit because I had to go. But anyway, I didn't see him no more, okay? I think I killed him. But God took bees back in the 60s now when the enemies of Israel, how many of y'all remember the old one-eyed general back then? And he took bees. And they come in the enemy's tanks, swarms of bees found the little breathing holes for the guys in the tanks, and come in there and started stinging those guys. Those guys opened the hatches, cut the motors off, or left them running, and run out of the tanks, and the Israeli army apprehended or got all the enemy tanks, or some of them anyway at that time. Isn't it amazing how God can even cause nature? Now that's happened while we're living. Well, while some of us were living. That was before Jerry. Okay, now, how many of y'all know that God can do a miracle in all kind of ways? Yes. You know, so don't give up and don't lose hope. I think all these songs this morning were just awesome. I mean, just awesome and encouraging and would arrest fears and stuff for some people that's afraid. We have nothing to be afraid about. We have nothing to be afraid about. We have nothing to fear. Come on, my wife says it this way. If somebody says they're going to kill her, if it came to that, You know what our answer is?
Don't tempt me with heaven.
You got it, sister. He said, what are you going to threaten me with? Heaven? You're going to threaten me with being absent in this body to be present with the Lord if you're going to kill me? And then, of course, she might remind them that they better repent or they'll never get to see him like that, except at the great white throne judgment. But, you know, what are they going to threaten us with? And over in the last book in the Bible, it's in Revelation 21, he says, but the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable. Let me just go ahead and tell you something. Anything that was abomination in God's sight, even under the law, before the law, during the law, whatever, after the law, anything that was abomination in the Word of God that he said was abominable is still abomination. And then he said, when it's all over, the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable shall all have their part, and all liars shall all have their part in the lake of fire. Regardless of what the law is, I'm going to say what the Word of God says. And when it comes to abortion, and I'm not doing that just more. I'm not trying to make anybody feel good that had an, feel bad that had an abortion, because God is faithful and just, and he forgives when we repent, when we say, God, I'm sorry. Now, if we don't tell him we're sorry, if we don't repent, well then, hey, for anything, you don't get automatic forgiveness. Just call, well, I kind of hate it, but I hadn't talked to God about it. No, you better talk to God about whatever it is. But how many of y'all understand God is not for murder? Come on. And Jeremiah said that when he was in the womb, that he knew him and he called him. So if you kill something, at whatever stage in the womb, that's already in God's sight. That's already somebody. That's our life. So abortion, let me tell you something. I would hate to be any doctor or any nurse that worked at one of those clinics, abortion clinic, and then knowing I've got to stand before God someday with the deeds that I've done, the acts that I've done, the procedures that I've performed. How many of y'all are with me? Now remember, they might be watching y'all too, and they'll take y'all with me. But I'm serious. I never have feared what man can do to me, and I don't mean that arrogant or cocky. I never have worried. The one that I've got to fear, and the one he told me to fear, is the one that had power over my soul to cast it in heaven or hell. Amen? I'm like Francis. They get me, they shoot me, then I'm just gone. I'm just to be present with the Lord. But I'm going to have to stand on the Word of God and preach the Word of God and tell the truth no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what the laws do. And far as, praise God, give him that. Isn't it amazing that they can say what they want to say, but they don't want me to say what I want to say, or you to say what you want to say, but they want to censor. Come on, what you say. Isn't it a shame? Isn't it childish? Isn't it stupid? Come on, isn't it? Now you can't say nothing. You can't speak against us. You can't reject, but we can say what we want to say, and we can cram anything down your throat that we want to. There are just some throats that won't cram. Come on. And I'm not trying to challenge anybody. Except people to pray. But I'm not trying to stir up anybody or stir up anything, because there's no telling who watches this. But I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to say what God says, and I'm going to read his word. That's the textbook that I use, and I've stuck with it all these years, and I'm going to continue to stick with it no matter what the world system comes to. That's all there is. There's people in Bible started jail ministries, and in the middle of being locked up, they begin to sing at midnight. Paul said, oh, Silas, you want to help me right now? I just feel like something good is about to happen. I just feel like something good is on its way. Oh, and what a mighty God we serve. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Whoa, do you hear something, Silas? What was that shaking? What was that rumbling? That mighty God come down busted that prison wide open and set them free. And even the guards that were guarding them, even on the inner chambers there, they were going to take their life because they knew that, boy, they'd be in trouble with their superiors. But they said, hey, don't do yourself no harm. And then they said, hey, Paul said, what must we do to be saved? Because they knew that God had come down and intervened. And let me tell you something. If God did that one time, he can do it again. Yeah. Amen. He can do it again. God can save America. Amen. Yeah. Look, if it's not his timing to have all this stuff happen right now before to bring the coming of the Lord here for the rapture of the church, then God can turn things around. God can do things that you don't even think. I've even said a few things that I feel probably going to happen, and I've been laughed at. I've been laughed to scorn nearly. I've been argued with, and I don't argue with them, but I just say, you just go ahead, buddy. You don't know my God. God can do anything. There is nothing too big for the God that we serve. There is nothing too hard for the God that we serve. Amen? Amen. Nothing. We still serve a miracle working God. He's still the same yesterday and forever. He can still open up a sea if he had to. He can open up a sea of sin, a sea of doubt. He can open up, come on, he can open up corruption, a sea of corruption. He can turn, let me tell you something. He can go to the Supreme Court and begin to move on their hearts. Amen. He can lay such a heavy fear on them that they would have to make some righteous decisions. How many of y'all believe God can move? God can move. God can do anything. And look, I'm not going to be surprised at what God does. I mean, look, you're looking at one guy. I'm just going to go ahead and tell you this. Until God says that's it and calls my number, if you want to call it that or whatever, I die, whatever. I may die this week. I don't know. If I do, be having this body to be present with the Lord. Amen. For me to live is Christ, but for me to die is gain. But I want you to know, I serve a miracle-working God, and I've seen him do too many miracles in my lifetime for me not to know and realize and believe that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and that he changes not. And not one thing he's spoken, if he really spoke it to anybody, if he really spoke it to any brother or any sister, then if he really spoke it, if he spoke it to them, then he didn't lie to them, and he's not lying. And some things will come to pass if God said they're going to come to pass, no matter what it is. So I had quite a bit of scripture. One of these days, maybe I'll get back to that. I've quoted some, but I want you not to operate and not run around in fear. I mean, Jerry, some of these songs, baby, that you led were just awesome. But don't run around in dreading and fearing and fretting. I was going to use Psalms, but I feel checked just not to go there right now this morning. I mean, not read it, because I was going to read a pretty long passage in Psalms even. God's going to take care. And people that will not repent, people that will not turn at his reproof. And how many of y'all would agree with me? Even politicians know when something is right and when something is not right. Come on. Even politicians know, even when they're voting on different bills and different things, and when they're hearing some cases and stuff, they know, even judges know, district attorneys know, lawyers know, and I'm going to go ahead and say concerning lawyers, there's a scripture that says, woe unto you lawyers. When you tax people with heavy burdens that cannot be borne, and you'll not lift one little finger to help ease that load. And you know, one of these days, if some lawyers and attorneys don't repent, now not all of them, I'm just saying the ones that know good and well. And how many of y'all know? You know they know when something is right that they're fighting for or when it's not right. They don't even care about whether it's right or whether somebody's innocent sometimes. Some of them do, but some of them don't. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? I'm not putting them all in the same. And I would be afraid to stand before God if I represented somebody, just try to get them free or get them off the hook that I knew was guilty or that I felt was guilty. I would leave that thing into somebody else's hands to judge and all. Neither would I want to be a judge sitting there making judgments and wrapping that hammer down, that wooden hammer on that desk, and passing a sentence on somebody knowing that they got to stand before the supreme judge of all this earth, the superior judge of all this earth, the judge of all this earth, and going to stand there before them. And I tell you, you know good and well that people that are in leadership positions, our politicians and all, they know when something's right and they know when something's wrong in most cases. And I want you to know, God moves upon hearts. Again, even us that are not in some of those positions, let me just real quick. How many of y'all have done several things that was wrong? Now, when you were doing it, number one, did you know it was wrong? Number two, when you were doing it anyway and went ahead, did you feel the conviction power of the Holy Spirit? Come on. Now, how many of y'all seriously either turned or repented? Okay, whether you turned right then, but later on you didn't turn, but then you repented. How many? That ought to cover about everybody there. Okay, well then, praise God, we get it covered with the blood of Jesus, okay? But we all know. But the people that will not turn at his reproof, this is what the Word of God says, the people that will not turn at his reproof, whenever their fear comes on them, and when their desolation comes, and it comes in like a whirlwind, God said, now this is what he said in the first chapter of Proverbs. He said, I'll mock and I'll laugh. One of these days God's going to laugh. And I promise you that God has been dealing with every senator through the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's keep praying. He's been dealing with all the, let me just go all the way to the top. He's dealt with the Supreme Court justices as well. You know good and well they got a human makeup to them. Just because they're exalted to a certain position don't mean that they're above. They put themselves sometime above the laws of the land or whatever, either try to create them and work them or approve them or disapprove or whatever, or legislate. But I want you to know they have got a supreme being above them, and I promise you the same Holy Spirit that works on you and I works on them as well, even to make right decisions and to not rule certain ways or to either rule certain ways. And when they violate that, I want you to know the power of the Holy Spirit is moving on them, trying to turn them around, trying to reproof them, trying to get them to be honest and trying to get them to do what's right. I'm talking about everybody in the everybody's above us, okay? And us included, God is trying to reprove people and trying to get them to do what's right. And if we'll yield to that, then we won't have to worry about God laughing at us or mocking us whenever we have fear and calamity come on us if something happened. And I believe with all my heart, God is moving on people. God is moving on people. And at any time, some of them could say, because let me ask you something. Have you ever had fear really come upon you that you felt the Lord was dealing with you on something? I mean, strong? Seriously, how many have? You really, because I know some of you've talked, yeah, several people. And I have too in some stuff, and especially years ago. And you could feel it, and you know that God is trying to get you to stop that or change or quit or whatever. And so whenever we'll turn and we'll repent at that, and that goes up to everybody that's under God, that's under heaven, if they will turn, if they'll change, if they'll do what's right, do justly, well, then God will forgive, God will bless them. But if it don't, then God's going to mock and God's going to laugh. And there are some people that the Spirit of God moves on so strong that they honestly don't even think they're going to live. They think their heart's going to explode or it's going to burst or they're going to have a heart attack. And I'm going to tell you something. God is able to move on people in different ways. And so let's just pray. How many of y'all will make it a matter of prayer? I mean serious prayer. And pray for America. pray for our leaders. I know some of you won't, maybe you will and didn't want to say you would, but whatever. But I would beg of you, you that will pray, you that don't mind praying, you that do talk to God, instead of being sometime low, oh God, help me, please do this for me, please get this, Lord, help me buy this, help me, oh Lord, please, please let this work out, oh Lord, please help my sore toe, it hurts so bad, Lord, please, please, please help my sore toe. I want us to pray a little deeper than that. I want us to have some fervent praying. You know, I want us to, and if we do, the Word of God says it will avail much. I'm gonna shut up. Let me just say that right now, again, these altars are open. If you just want to come talk to God just a minute about something, or 2 or 3 minutes or 5 minutes or whatever, it don't make no difference to me. These altars are open. I'm not gonna, if somebody here was lost, you sure ought to come and get found. You sure ought to come and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ before you leave out of them doors, because anything could happen up and down these highways and you might not have another chance. And if you're here and you know you're out of fellowship with God, you ought to come. You know how long it takes to get in fellowship with God? Just hear His voice and open the door and He'll come in. You can have fellowship with Him then. And the rest of you, it won't bother anybody that wants to come, but the rest of you, if you wanna go, then I'm gonna say, okay, God bless you, you're dismissed. Thank you for coming to Oasis of Love this morning. We love you. I'm not discouraged, I'm not down, I'm not afraid, I'm not fearful, I'm really not. I hate it for what's going on in the political world. I hate it, I hate it. I hate all the depression of the church and the schools. I mean, this is gonna affect a lot of things, you know, if they have their way. It will shut a lot of people down. Now, don't get me wrong, it won't shut the real church down, because it'll go wide open. And I want you to know, if we all of a sudden have miracle funds come in, well, we're going to go forward and we'll build a new auditorium, and we'll believe God to see souls saved and born into the family of God. You know, as long as we got the funds. If we don't have funds, we have to just wait and wait on the Lord. And I don't have any plans whatsoever, so don't read anything into that, except that I felt something a long time ago. So, but if God provides the funds, then we will go forward. We'll move forward. If He does, I'll just call it miracle funds, okay? If He does that, because some of y'all would have to have a miracle for y'all to be able to even contribute or give substantial, above and beyond normal offerings or whatever. But God's able. How many of y'all know God's able to put a gas well right in your backyard? If you own the property, how many of y'all believe God could do that? That happened to friends of mine. Wondered what he was going to do. In fact, he had just gave, it's amazing. He had just gave about $350,000 to a ministry. Sold his house to do it. Because that's what he felt led to do. And about a week or two later, a truck drove up in his yard and asked, did they mind if he go shooting some sounds down in the ground on his little old 18 acres or whatever it was. And when they did that, just a month or so later, he was set for life. Isn't it amazing what God can do? How many of y'all believe God can do it? Did you know God could put you in a wheel? Some of y'all have already been put in a wheel before, and that's great, that's awesome. But you know, God could put some more people in the wheel that would you just have more funds available than what your tithing offering off of it. God just bless a few folks with more than build a brand new facility where you preach the gospel. But we're going to preach the gospel, amen? Hey, we love you. God bless you. Thank you for being here. You hang around this altar as long as you want to and seek the face of the Lord. Thank God for you. By video, thank you for being a part of our service today at Oasis.